This is the Christmas news, according to VT, from the BBC. Your newsreader tonight is Moira Stuart.
Good evening. Welcome to the VT Christmas news. And we're going to take a look back at some of the more unusual things that have gone on in the year. In February, Cary Grant was seen in the programme planning office trying to book some three-machine editing.
Sweet A.
Oh, Sweet A?
It's our best.
I'd rather not have it, if you don't mind.
I beg your pardon?
Have you anything else?
Sweet C.
I couldn't take that Sweet A because I've been here before.
Apparently, he had problems the last time he worked on the fourth floor. The television recording management are making a video for Christmas this year. It's said to have cost £14,000. Here's a preview from it. Unfortunately, it won't be ready for this Christmas, so the managers have postponed it until Christmas 1988. The government has recently produced a series of promotional films to try and encourage today's youth to find employment. A spokesman said each film has been made to try and combat the fears and prejudices that exist in our jobless society. He also said even the dullest, lowest paid jobs look quite interesting when you make a film about it. Here's an example.
I was at home, no job, no money, no fun. You could cut the atmosphere with a knife.
Doing something or other, God knows what. You should get off your backside and get a job.
Mum was right. I knew I'd better do something fast.
Yeah, that's right. A job. The only money we've got coming in is my bingo earnings. Look, £3.90.
Well, it's better than last week's winnings. All we had to live on then was a box of chocolates and stuffed rabbit. Stuffed bleeding rabbit.
Get a job. Get a job. I'll have you know, woman, the Broad family hasn't had a job in three generations. You want me to ruin a century-long tradition just so you can eat bleeding caviar? What's wrong with eating bingo winnings, anyway?
Well, not when you eat all soft centres.
Listen, Crystal, that's enough of your bleeding backchat. If I have any more trouble from you, you'll get the back of my hand. Now finish off your rabbit leftovers.
Leave her alone, you bastard.
Ah, shut up, man.
You can come alone. Don't you call her names.
I knew there must be better things.
Stop it, the lot of you. I'm fed up with it all. I'm going to go out and get a job.
There we go, Raymond. That boy's got more spirit than the rest of us put together in this family.
Well, I think he's a bleeding disgrace.
Oh, fuck!
Excuse me. Yes, you. Give us a minute. I want to ask you one question. I want to know whether you've ever wondered how BBC programmes are brought to your screens. Have you, for instance, considered a job behind the scenes? Well, how about becoming a recording operator?
This job at the Beeb looked interesting. I thought it might apply.
Hello,
So here I am, the first grouch to try for a job in 3 generations. Oh well, here goes.
Come in. Ah, good morning, laddie. You've come about the job in Telrec, have you?
That's right. I saw Maggie Philbin in the TV shop, and she told me all about it.
Ah, yes, right. Well, there's nothing like getting young lads in off the street, that's what I say. Now, I'll explain. I'm going to just be assistant for people, so my superior will be along in a few moments. So take a seat. And can you tell me the 3x table?
Once 3 is 3. 2 3s are 6. 3.
Great.
Three.
Okay, very good. Now, can you spell the word promotions?
R-O-M-O.
Brilliant. You're the best guy we've had all day. Now, just sign it, please.
Just here.
Well, I mean, ignore all that small print rubbish. Just remember that you're lucky to have a job at all, okay?
But don't I have to have a medical or something like that?
Medical, yes. I'm glad you mentioned that. Hold on, I'll just see if my superior's in his office.
Hello?
Yes, I've got a new recruit here. He needs a medical.
Okay, just tell him to drop his trousers and bend over the desk. I'll be along in a jiffy.
Well, there you go. Come on, get on with it.
Bend over!
What are you doing here?
Mr. Raymond Graunch is currently serving a 10-year prison sentence for indecency. In the summer, top government agents seized some film and videotapes from BBC Scotland's offices. They thought they had confiscated material from the Secret Society programme. Here, though, is an extract from what they really saw when running through the tapes.
If it's going to be one of those days when you need to keep a little cooler, a little drier, and a lot more comfortable, use pure Johnson's baby powder.
Oh, my baby! Oh, boy, do I need that!
Also in Scotland, the television recording management have set up a punishment centre. In an effort to curb large overtime bills, rigorous demoralising treatment is practised.
About... turn! Left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right.
Stop grinning at the front there. You're not supposed to be enjoying this. Left, right, left, right.
Occasionally, one of the inmates escapes from the compound, but is quickly spotted by the distinctive blue jacket that he wears. Overtime is now not a problem in television recording. As part of the BBC's stringent efforts to create extra revenue, each production department was asked to devise new ways of making money. Promotions department's leading light, Pat Hubbard, hit on the idea of forming a presentation pop group and asked Philip Schofield, top record producer, to mould his team. This report from Sebastian Prickett.
Phil, baby, you work with all the greats, the Rolling Stones...
Yeah?
The Beatles, the Gumby Dance Band. Why take on a bunch of nobodies?
Well, Seb, it's like this, you know, you can't just resist the challenge, and it was either that or the Jazz and Dave Easter album, you know?
So, when did you first see the presentation pop group?
Well, let me think back. Pat sent me some demo tapes of the band's early efforts. I think they called themselves... a line act in the comments or something. Pat had gone for the little boy image, but they were hopeless. I didn't know how I'd make anything out of these simple-minded hippies, really.
Even so, you persisted with the band.
Well, yeah, I did persist with the band, yeah. They were rough, but I could tell they had something.
Presence? The hidden talent?
No, it wasn't that. I think it was the suspenders.
So, things were difficult to begin with.
Oh, well, our first recording session together was a little bit of a disaster, really.
Well, I know punk was out in this one.
perversion image just wouldn't sell records.
Yet you transform them into a chart-topping group.
As you can see, I had my work cut out. There was a change of lineup, a style, a whole new approach. Now, we've now released our first hit single, and sales are well over 3.5 million. Well, no, 3.5. Can I interest you in the other half of it?
Thank you. And do you think the band's recent appearance on Top of the Pops will guarantee success?
Well, I'll work for the Gumby Dance Band. I don't see why that can't happen for them. Can somebody like this goddamn thing?
And exclusive to Top of the Pops tonight, we have record producer Philip Schofield's latest release, a hopeful Christmas number one. Here's Tina Traylor and the Promotions.
When you're alone and life is making you lonely, you can always go downtown. When you've got worries, all the noise and the hurry seems to help, I know. Downtown, just listen to the music of the traffic in the city. Linger on the sidewalk where the neon signs are pretty. How can you lose? The lights are much brighter there. You can't forget all your troubles, forget all your cares. So go downtown, where all the lights are bright. Downtown, waiting for
In August, a VT editor took up an acting career. His first part was as a lover in a little-known Australian soap opera. Here's a clip.
And who might be taking you to America for the evening, young Daphne?
Why, the love of my life.
John O'Connor!
John O'Connor! Don't you know his father tried to bankrupt me?
Throughout the year, the men's toilets in the basement of Television Centre have been subject to closure. We have just received some exclusive pictures of the sort of thing that's been going on. From time to time in the newsroom, there aren't enough stories to make a very long or interesting programme. In a recent Sun newspaper exclusive, two twins were named in a rather unsavoury affair concerning large sums of money handed over by the BBC. What follows is a dramatic reconstruction of how the criminals were brought to justice.
No good, you know. We're just gonna have to find ourselves another job, Ronnie. I'm so bored, it's just too dull around here.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Creating world disasters is a patchy business. Sometimes they happen all on their own, and we don't have anything to do with it.
Yeah, that's correct. Take the winds last October, for instance. Had nothing to do with them, it uprooted nearly every tree and plant in Britain.
Yeah, I know. Why don't we watch some of our videotapes of our previous disasters? That might give us some inspiration.
Great idea, yeah. Here we go.
Yay. Ah, Chernobyl. That was a good one. Got paid by the BBC £250,000 for that one, didn't we?
That sounds about right, yeah. It was really easy though, wasn't it? Just a case of substituting a few plastic explosives for the fuel rods. The Russians never found out.
I guess.
Trouble is, I'm still having to go and see the doctor.
Is that your radiation burns?
No, they cleared up. It's my nose. Glows in the dark.
Ah, the Falklands War. Now, this was one of my favourites.
There's General Galtieri there.
Mm. 25 de Mayo de 1982.
Hey, General! Why don't you invade the Falklands?
En el Día de la Patria. Buenos días!
Hello. Disaster Twins PLC?
BBC News here. Is that Mr. Disaster?
Yes, speaking. It's the BBC.
Look, we've got a traffic lull in our news stories at the minute. We need a good disaster to last, say, 3 weeks. All that we're transmitting at the moment are stories about puppets falling down mine shafts and what's happening inside Lady Diana's knickers. I wonder if you can help us. It's the usual fee.
How about another stock market crash? That was one of our better ones recently.
Outings to Boulogne are a real hoot, aren't they, chaps? 15 pints of lager, and we haven't left the port yet.
You said jamming burn doors open was easy. It's taking ages. The bloke from the BBC wanted the ship to sink just out of harbour so he could film it.
You're just too slow, that's all. Remember when we sat in Belgrano, you're just flaming useless.
God, I feel sick. I'm going to have to go to the lab.
Yeah. OK, it's gone.
Twins Chrissy and Ronald Disaster were discovered by the police, fined £5 in court, and were asked not to do it again. Finally, as part of the BBC's latest cutbacks, a new quiz show has been introduced. Questionable Sports has been made for just £24 per show. Instead of using an expensive studio, the production team have hired a Salvation Army hut in North Acton. And as an end to the VT Christmas news, we're going to show you the new look.
And now, the quiz of the year. BBC's cheapest show ever, Questionable Sports. And here is your host with that cheeky smile, Pierre Wazoo.
Welcome to this special edition of Questionable Sports. Not what are they, but why are they? Let's meet our two teams this week. First, the sporting super sleuths. Captain Bazza Barwick, the man who put grand in grandstand. Sharon Shortchange, the lady who's still looking for the shuttlecock at the badminton horse trials. Charlie Clipboards, the man who thinks the pole position is between Hungary and Russia. Sporting super sleuths. And on my left, the team that are left, the VT All-Stars. Captain Dick Scanner, the man who gave a new meaning to the word in-vision flashing. In White, the lady who gave us a special performance in this year's Christmas Tape. And Admiral Barkoff, the man from outer space who didn't want to go home. Well, we've met both the teams. Let's see tonight's star prize.
Tonight's star prize, Pierre, is set in the most exotic Mediterranean resort you could imagine. Capstan Servo is a little-known island off the Spanish coast. It boasts the best windsurfing facilities in the world, and it's all being shown on Questionable Sports.
Well, that's the star prize. Let's see the prize for round one.
Well, Pierre, this prize is what every athlete needs on his feet, a tin of Mycil foot powder.
Right, let's start round one. Question one goes to Dick Scanner. The scene is the World Cup operation in VT in 1966. Who is the mystery person operating the video disc?
Greg, on the phone, Greg. Bloody slow motion is going backwards.
Things are not going too well there, so that might be a clue.
3:30, after about 40 minutes play, and where do we pick it up?
Well, Dick, you're on your, you've got your team to help you. Lots of clues there.
Not at all pushy, but I would guess...
Bird-like features, do you think?
Jonathan Martin.
Excellent. Well, let's have a look and see if that's true. I think you might be right on that one. You're right, Jonathan Martin. Question two goes to Captain Bazabarwick. Watch this clip. I want you to tell me whose is the mystery voice at this athletics meeting. This is quite a difficult one, Baza.
Is that the only... If you're going to piss around like that all night, I'm going to have those headphones wrapped around your bollocks. I knew I did it very fucking deliberately because thanks to the editor's lack of ability to change things, I've had to put a load of crap in there that I can't read.
It's tricky, isn't it? Four ahead.
it's warm.
Gordon McGover?
Well, I think we've got to give it to you there, haven't we? Yes, absolutely. For a bonus point, can you tell me how many swear words there were in that round?
I could spell most of them.
Oh, absolutely right, what a crushing So our sports superstars are in the lead at the moment. Well, let's see how they do with this question. Here's a clip from the classic 1979 Christmas tape.
Yeah, you fucking fuck off.
So if you should happen to be out one night or so, I'm gonna ask you why you feel so low.
What's wrong with my
poor sod's eating plans?
Just remember, he's like the other guys. He may not want them all to know.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm a new sports PA.
How many items were thrown at that good-looking young man there?
Same person. I haven't seen around.
No, I haven't seen him for years.
He's probably moved on to bigger and better things.
Certainly bigger.
Yeah.
Certainly
bigger
things, yeah.
Remarkably slim long now.
I would have said seven. Used to pull all the birds, would you
think? I've got to accept that, yes. The answer is six. I have to... The winners of that round clearly are our sporting superstars. They have won this useful tin of Mycil foot powder. Now we're going to give you the scores right at the end of the game because it makes the editing of this program a lot easier. Let's have a look at the prize for round two.
Okay, Pierre, on our tree this time is a memento from the last test match. It's Imran Khan's box.
I've got Imran Khan's,
I think it could be right there, yes.
It's a standing gas, isn't it?
In this round, we ask our teams to mime, and the other team have to guess what they're miming. And it's the turn of the VT superstars, who already know their mime, and they're going to perform, and sports superstars have to guess what it is they're doing. Any ideas?
I'm just enjoying that bit, actually.
Doesn't do anything for me.
I don't know whether it's within the rules, but can we have a look at that bit again? It's not people don't need. It's my little lunchbox, isn't it?
That's very close, isn't it?
It's a Sony.
I'm going to give it you anyway. It was, in fact, a VPR6. Well, can VT All-Stars match that? They've got to watch sporting superstars perform their mime. Not sure we can transmit this sort of thing, but... I think that comes under the new broadcasting restrictions. But an excellent mime. Any ideas, VT All-Stars?
We think it was the sports department Christmas party.
Oh, well. It was actually a three-man bobsleigh.
Oh, thank you.
The first round, I'm going to present you with Imran Khan's cricket box. Well, keep cracking rounds. Now, remember, this third and final round is for the star prize. And question one is to sports superstars. Look at this clip. There are two table tennis players, and what I want you to tell me is what happens next.
I was in the gallery. I'm tempted. Sharon Lentz gave the wrong duration, and Charles Balchin, we went to black.
That's
awfully close, isn't it? I'm tempted to give you that because let's have a look at it though and see what really did happen.
Oh, well, he's
you fell into the table. You were so close. He actually knew himself.
I can't give you full marks.
I'm going to give you half a point for that because I think you were that was a good answer.
I think a little hard, actually.
The next question goes to VT All Stars. Spot the fugitive. I want you to tell me who is this sports personality being pursued on this clip.
You dodgy geezer! Oi, let's have him! Oi, let's have this kid!
This is a VT question, you can confirm. Who is that? It's really almost too easy.
I'm going to make a wild guess and say Chris Lewis.
Well, let's have a look. Chris Lewis, is that Chris
Looks
Lewis?
Looks like Chris Lewis's haircut. It's the Chris Lewis haircut.
Well done, VT. It is indeed.
I'll go down.
Oh, no. Now, sports, keep looking at this, because there's a question coming up on this clip to you.
Sorry about that. This is Chris Lewis.
You see what this looks like on Saturday.
What was Chris Lewis's dry cleaning bill to have that white jacket dry cleaned?
I think it's now used at the Turk's Head as a beer mocker-upper. I don't think it wasn't cleaned.
Autographed by Harry Potter.
I think that's right. Yes, I'm going to give you that point. Excellent answer. VT, look at this clip. We've got two special guests, and I want you to tell me what was the present.
Before everybody finishes.
Oh, yes.
Before everybody finishes, because it's Sue's 40th birthday.
Keep filming.
We have something here for the BBC, specifically for the Christmas tape have at Christmas, and this is a small present for
this
you.
This is a very happy
40th
birthday.
I think, is it something that she could open now?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Oh, it's something very, very little, and very, but I mean, just always.
How wonderful.
Very happy birthday. Anyway.
Thank you very much indeed. It's going to be something awful, isn't it?
No.
We should have signed it.
We'll sign it afterwards.
Happy Christmas, VT, stand by.
Lots of clues in that.
We think that it was a wax effigy of the editor of a certain Fleet Street newspaper, complete with pins.
What a good answer, but it's wrong, I'm afraid.
Hugh Williams' divorce papers.
You're very close to that, but it was, in fact, a sports lunchbox.
Oh. That
was a lovely trip, you'll see.
Yes,
she's opening the crackers and the cheese and the butter. There you are, you see. Almost too easy. Well, what a cracking round that was to finish on. And clearly the winners of our star prize tonight are the sports superstars. Did they do well? So So let's remind ourselves of that star prize.
And what a terrific star prize this is, Pierre. The amazing blue sea, arid landscapes, scorching heat, five-star hotels, and miles upon miles of perfect beaches. These are perfect conditions for windsurfing. But tonight, the sporting sleuths have won a pocket wind meter.
Measure the velocity of all that hot air that floats around Ken House. Isn't that a useful thing? But nobody goes away empty-handed on this programme.
Well, Pierre, the VT All-Stars have won a little prize too. Yes, on this same exotic island of Capstan Servo, they have won the consolation prize of 4 weeks' holiday in a five-star hotel with all windsurfing tuition thrown in for free.
Well, we hope you've enjoyed this special edition. My thanks to both the teams, and from me and all of us, a very good night. Bye.
And that's all for this year. Merry Christmas to all our viewers.